These days, we moderns all possess a kind of built-in arrogance about our superiority to earlier cultures, what C.S. Lewis once called chronological snobbery. In contrast to medieval man, who tended to think of the ancients as greater than he was, we modern men are inclined to think that because of our technological and scientific progress, we know more and live better than anyone who ever came before us. In particular, we like to think of ourselves as vastly superior when it comes to knowledge of space. Watch Christopher Nolan's Interstellar, and you'll hear battered around terms of black holes, neutron stars, gravitational fields, relativity, wormholes, and so forth. Dante's cosmos, then, with the Earth at the center and all the planets neatly revolving around it, seems at first glance positively primitive. Thus, before we can appreciate how exciting Dante's readers would have thought his journey in Paradiso was, we have to know something about what medieval men thought about the heavens in the first place. But in this lecture, I don't just want to relate some of their ideas about the cosmos. Rather, I want to try to recreate the medieval experience of looking at the nighttime sky. That is, I want to conduct a kind of phenomenology of the medieval cosmos, talking about not just what it looked like and how it worked, but what it felt like. To this end, I will organize this lecture around four major points. First, I'll talk about the order of the heavens, how medieval man looked up at the sky and saw it as a kind of visual symphony. Then, I'll talk about the love and the cosmos, that is, how love was felt to flow through the world, conducting creatures to their natural end. Thirdly, I want to talk about how light was thought to play almost a spiritual role in the world. And I'll focus on the medieval paradox that God is both everywhere in the world, but also present in some places more than others. And finally, I'll conclude by showing how Dante magnificently weaves all these themes together in the conversation the pilgrim has with Piccarda Donati, who makes her appearance in Canto 3. Well, with that as an outline, let's turn to thinking about the order of heaven and what it sounded like. We have to recognize that even if we as a culture might know more about some things far away, Dante and his contemporaries had a better understanding about the practical appearance of the nighttime sky on any given evening. In fact, Dante's detailed knowledge everywhere on display is extraordinary. Unless you're the kind of person who has an annual subscription to Astronomers Monthly, then you will probably not have a clue what Dante was talking about in Paradiso 1 when he begins to describe his ascent. The lamp of the world rises on us mortals at different points, but by the one that joins four circles with three crossings, it comes forth on a better course and in conjunction with a better sign. In other words, it's late March, and the sun is in the constellation of Aries. This and many other bits of astronomical information lead me to believe that Dante had a sky chart entirely within his mind, and he seems to have expected his readers to possess the same internal map. He notes the constellations, how the planets move through them, the phases of the moon, the appearance of the sun throughout the zodiac, and so forth. It's as if he could close his eyes and not just visualize a model of the Earth at the center and the planets around it, but he could spin it in his mind and watch it revolve, rotate, and see how the nesting proportional layers overlapped. But in addition to being more familiar with the nighttime sky's motions, I think medieval man probably took delight and even comfort in looking at it. This was in part because the medieval model of the cosmos was of a universe which was orderly and close in. At the center of the cosmos, of course, was the Earth. And then came the moon, which divided the atmosphere from the heavenly ether. Next was Mercury, Venus, the Sun, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, and then the sphere in which all the stars were thought to be lodged, like gems set into a transparent band of crystal. When we get closer to it, we'll talk about the pilgrim's journey even beyond the stars. But for now, note that the pilgrim will travel to each one of these spheres and meet souls there. And on occasion, we'll step back for a moment, turn around, and take in a view of the whole. And this is important because medieval man thought the distance between those planets was spaced out in harmonic intervals. In a similar way to how the frequency of one note in a chord resonates harmoniously with a second note in the chord to make, say, a fifth, medieval man thought the interval between one planet and the next was spaced out in harmonic chords, as it were. There are even some ancient authors who referred to the universe as a lute, because the planets were all spaced out like musical chords. The world then performed a kind of visual symphony, a score whose notes were plucked by the daily movements of the heavenly bodies. This is well illustrated in Cicero's famous Dream of Scipio, a text read all throughout the Middle Ages. The Roman general, Scipio, has a dream in which he experiences an imaginative journey in which his soul flies through the spheres of the heavens, and when it reaches the apex of the universe, it turns around and sees the whole universe stretched out at his feet. "What is this sound so loud and yet so sweet that fills my ears?" he asks. And his guide answers, "That is the sound produced by the impetus and momentum of the spheres themselves. It's made up of intervals which, though unequal, are determined systematically by fixed proportions. The blend of high and low notes produces an even flow of various harmonies. By imitating this system with strings and voices, experts have succeeded in opening a way back to this place. But filled with this sound, people's ears have become deaf to it." In other words, the music created by the spheres, to which we have now become deaf to, can be regained through study or through beautiful music which imitates the same harmonic proportions which space out the heavenly bodies. Thus we can see that whereas we modern men tend to think of space as being a cavernous depth in which there are things we know not of billions of miles away, hidden away in the utter darkness of their chaotic landscape, medieval man saw the universe as harmonious and comforting, centering within a world which made sense. As C.S. Lewis famously put it in his Discarded Image, quote, "Nothing is more deeply impressed on the cosmic imaginings of a modern than the idea that the heavenly bodies move in a pitch black and dead cold vacuity." It was not so in the medieval model. You must conceive yourself looking up at a world lighted, warmed, and resonant with music. Pascal's terror at the eternal silence of that infinite emptiness had never entered his mind. He's like a man being conducted through an immense cathedral, not like one lost in a shoreless sea. And this is the same experience that Dante enjoys when he's taken up into heaven. When he describes the pilgrim's first entry into that warm world of light and harmony in Paradiso 1, he says, "O love who ruled the heavens and drew me up there with your light. When the eternal heavens you made, wheeling in desire, caught my attention with the harmony you temper and attune, then so much of the sky seemed set on fire. The newness of the sound and the bright light lit in me such a keen desire to know their causes as I had never with such sharpness felt before." Dante sees the world and feels it saturated with peace and love. But at the same time that he feels the deep peace of the place, he's also struck again and again by its dazzling brightness. Again, in the medieval world, which was not flooded by artificial lights, it was possible to take a delight in the quality of color or light, to almost taste its radiance in a way which is hard for us to conceive. The famous Italian scholar Umberto Eco, in his book Art and Beauty in the Middle Ages, describes the sensuous presence that beautiful gems, colorful works of art, or sparkling objects of wonder had on medieval man. Quote, "The passage from aesthetic pleasure to mystical joy is virtually instantaneous," Eco says. "Feelings of artistic beauty were converted at the moment of their occurrence into a sense of communion with God and a kind of joie de vivre," end quote. But what is more, just as we all know that the orbit of the moon affects the tides of large bodies of water, so too did medieval man think all heavenly bodies had their influence on Earth. Looking at the stars wasn't just pretty, but it was opening yourself to spiritual powers which penetrated your body. Their beauty was almost spiritually radioactive. Incidentally, it's this feeling for the heavens which Lewis tried to recapture in his space trilogy. For his contemporaries then, the idea of flying through that place of peace and radiance par excellence, simply on the level of story, would have been a wildly exciting sci-fi journey. To get to visit this region bathed in happiness and light, that light and happiness which we only get a fraction of as it trickles down from sphere to sphere. It's this very physical and visceral feeling for the physical effects of light and music which helps us account for Dante's often breathless tone. I was in that heaven which receives more of his light. He who comes down from there can neither know nor tell what he has seen. And so medieval man looked up at the sky, saw it as beautiful, radiant, dazzling, and ordered. Or rather, he felt it as perfection. It always moved in order, always obeyed, and it always sang. But although the starry sky was the paradigm for ordered motion and beauty, the belief was that this order, this love, if you will, flowed through the world, and in fact kept everything in motion. And this is my second major point, that it was felt that love guided the seasons as they yielded to one another, like ladies in a medieval figure dance. It was love which ensured that the sea harmoniously lapped the land without overflowing its boundaries. It was love, even, that bound the soul to the body. In a famous poem which monks memorized and chanted in their classrooms, Boethius praised the order of the world, what he called cosmic music or cosmic love. O Lord, you govern the universe with your eternal order. You brought time itself into being and all that marks its changes in the heavens and here on the earth, you who are both moving and also in stillness. The world's beauty is your beauty. Your mind is the source of its grandeur, as you shaped it to your liking, imposing upon it your order, which harmonizes the many elements that compose it. The cold with the fiery hot, the dry with the wet, lest any fly off on its own and unbalance the equipoise of creation. In other words, Boethius points out that there's no good reason why the elements don't just repel one another and fly off in their own directions. Somehow, some way, they remain united in a body. For Boethius, then, this harmony or music or glue which holds them together is divine love, which has its source in the heart of God, who keeps pouring out his love through his own largesse in order that the world remain together. Later in the Consolation, Boethius tries to explain how such order comes about, and he says that each creature has an interior movement, a love, a hunger, a desire to be what it is, and in seeking out its own perfection, it thus seeks out the ultimate good. As Boethius puts it, the good is both the rudder which directs the creature and the port to which it hopes to return. Boethius gives the example of a tree, which grows in a harsh environment, say, out here in Wyoming. It struggles for survival. It sticks its roots way down into the hard ground to draw up into itself as much nourishment as it can. In other words, it does everything it can to keep itself in existence. You could say it tries to maintain its own unity. It tries to keep itself from falling to pieces, from dying and turning back into the molecules of dust. But ultimately, Boethius says, God is unity. Thus, the individual tree, in maintaining its unity, is an imitation of God, as if it preserved its own good intact because it was so moved by the ultimate vision of the good. Aquinas teaches the same thing. In the words of the scholar David Gallagher, quote, according to his teleological understanding of nature, and indeed the whole universe, Thomas Aquinas maintains that each being possesses an appetite, an inner tendency or inclination by which it tends toward its own appropriate perfection. This, for Thomas, is one of the marvels of creation, that God did not create beings which would be moved only from external causes, but rather endowed beings with their own interior principles of motion. End quote. In this way, by seeking to maintain their own goodness, creatures become what Aquinas calls similitudines divini, or divine emulations. This is abstract stuff. So before we turn back to Dante, I want to share one last author who exemplifies the poetic capacity of this vision of a cosmos of creatures, each seeking out God by trying to do well what it is. In a poem by the experimental Jesuit poet Gerard Manley Hopkins, who of course was not a medieval author, but he was nourished by the same authors who inspired Dante, Hopkins says, in As Kingfishers Catch Fire, "As kingfishers catch fire, dragonflies draw flame, as tumbled over rim and roundy wells, stones ring. Like each tucked string tells, each hung bell's bow swung, finds tongue to find out, fling out broad its name. Each mortal thing does one and the same, deals out that being indoors each one dwells. Selves goes itself, myself it speaks and spells, crying, what I do is me, for that I came." The poem's a bit difficult because of its experimental sound, but what Hopkins' point is that as the dragonfly zips by in its blazing, buzzing movement, as the stone clicks and clacks as it tumbles down and around the walls of a well, as each thing performs its nature, it calls out its inner name. In a way, it shows forth its own individual goodness. But then Hopkins continues, "I say more. The just man justices, keeps grace that keeps all his goings graces. Acts in God's eyes what in God's eyes he is, Christ, for Christ plays in 10,000 places. Lovely in limbs and lovely in the eyes, not his, to the Father through the features of men's faces." For Hopkins, as well as for Boethius and Aquinas and Dante, the whole universe is full of things which, by doing well what they are, proclaim not only their inner selves, but also seek out God in doing so. And thus they each become reflections of the face of Christ, as if God were looking out at the world, and in each of the creatures which he has made, he sees his face looking back at him, as if the whole universe were mirrors. For Christ plays in 10,000 places, lovely in limbs and lovely in eyes, not his, to the Father through the features of men's faces. This then is how that love flows through the world. Each creature, by being itself, seeks out God. By craving to remain in existence, each thing imitates that God who is always eternally present. And it is this vision of the cosmos which Beatrice presents to Dante as his sort of basic introductory lecture to the ways of heaven. In a lengthy but gorgeous speech, Beatrice, gesturing at the world spread out before Dante's eyes, gives him a picture of this world of creatures, each of which is busily seeking out God by obeying its own nature. She says, "All things created have an order in themselves, and this begets the form that lets the universe resemble God. In that order, all natures have their bent according to their different destinies. They move, therefore, toward different harbors upon the vastness of the sea of being, each imbued with an instinct that impels it on its course. This instinct carries fire toward the moon. It's a force in mortal hearts. This binds the earth to earth." In other words, the power which allows the animal to move, the plant to grow, the rock to fall, the fire to rise, is a kind of love which flows through the veins of the world, but manifests itself in ways which differ in accordance with the individual nature of each type of creature. And Dante imagines this picture like a man standing on a mountain near the sea, watching all the ships floating on the ocean, each seeking out its own harbor. At this point, you might be satisfied and content. It's a beautiful vision of the world, isn't it? A kind of mountaintop view in which the things you see so far below you are moving in tranquility. But there's more. Yes, in Dante there's always more. Because in addition to the fact that every creature seeks God by seeking its own good, it's also the case that creatures have different capacities to know and love God. And it's here that I begin to move into my third point, the role that light plays in the medieval cosmos. For the medieval mind, the difference between the capacity of creatures to absorb the presence of God was brilliantly illustrated in how reflective some forms of matter were. For example, coal is black and oily and absorbs light into it. Dark, dirty, greasy coal has little reflective power. But even coal, if you light it on fire, for example, can release a beautiful burning light. But other types of matter, say a diamond or an emerald, were just made to be filled with brilliant light. They let light flow all through them, hardly obstructing the path of it at all. The topaz can be saturated by that light of heavenly peace. The dull stone cannot. This idea has its parallel when we speak of how different creatures relate to God. Even though it is the case that all creatures seek out God by a kind of internal movement, some can imbibe more of his light than others. One great author, Otto von Simpson, who wrote Gothic Cathedral, said that for medieval man, the cathedral was meant to be a kind of representation of the universe. And at the same time, the universe was meant to be thought of as a kind of temple. Just as light flowed through the colored windows of the Gothic cathedral, so too does light penetrate the universe. Or as von Simpson puts it, according to the thinkers of the Middle Ages, light is the most noble of natural phenomena. Light is the creative principle in all things, most active in the heavenly spheres, whence it causes all organic growth here on earth, and weakest in the earthly substances. But it's present even in them. For, asks St. Bonaventure, do not metals and precious stones begin to shine when we polish them? Are not clear window panes manufactured from sand and ashes? Is not fire struck from black coal? And is not this luminous quality of things evidence of the existence of light in all of them? All of this helps us understand that first Terzina of Paradiso. The glory of him who moves all things pervades the universe and shines in one part more and in another less. God then is present to every creature, but he's closer to some on account of the fact that they are more present to him. This is also the main lesson of Paradiso 2, to which I wish to turn now. In our last lecture, we talked about how Dante warned all of his readers in Paradiso 2 to go back to the shore, lest they drown on open sea. And if in any canto there's threat of drowning, it's surely in Canto 2 of Paradiso, which spends almost 100 lines talking about medieval scientific theories as to why there are dark spots on the moon. This canto wins my prestigious gold medal award of the single most boring canto in the comedy. But as with other boring canti, such as the canto on generation and reproduction in Purgatorio 25, Dante has a point, indeed a deep point, if we're patient enough to sound the depths. In Paradiso 2, Beatrice uses the moon as a kind of object lesson for explaining the nature of the universe. The fact is, she tells Dante, the dark and light patches of the moon, observable from the earth, are not due to the fact that in some places the matter is more dense and in others less dense, but rather is due to the fact that different parts of the moon have different capacities to absorb and reflect light. Now, Dante and his contemporaries thought that all the stars were embedded in that crystalline sphere which rotates at the outermost boundary of the universe, and thus the difference in brightness between the stars could not be due to greater distance from the earth. Rather, the stars themselves have different capacities, again, in absorbing the spiritual nourishment distributed from on high, and then pouring that out again in the form of their splendor. Thus, the whole world should be thought of as one body, pervaded by the love which runs through its veins, but each part of the world absorbs that nourishing blood and shapes it into different tissues, which then perform different functions. One body with many organs, as Beatrice says. Now, it might come as a surprise, but this is also the case on the spiritual level with human beings. Just as some forms of matter in the universe are more capable of absorbing God's light, some human beings have a greater ability to absorb more of God. Or to change the metaphor slightly, some are able to see more because they're brighter. And so, yes, some human beings are happier than others in heaven, even if all of them are completely happy. All cups are overflowing, although some cups are larger than others. How exactly does that work? Here Dante seems to be relying on the thought of Thomas Aquinas. The limit of our ability to participate in this cosmos of love, or to see the source of love, is determined by the love or charity we have on an individual basis. Aquinas, taking up the verse to 1 Corinthians 15:41, says, "Star differs from star in glory." And he argues that some in heaven will, quote, "see the essence of God more perfectly than another," end quote. Aquinas points out that because God's being is on a level entirely above ours, then our minds cannot comprehend his essence. But God is willing to provide a gift of understanding, a sort of eye on loan, through which we can see the divine essence. Or to bring it closer to Aquinas' metaphor, God's light is so bright, it blinds our feeble eyes. But he will give us the gift of a light in which we can see his brilliant darkness. In this way, Aquinas provides a lovely interpretation of the psalm, "In your light we will see light." This gift of light, which is necessary for seeing God, is called the light of glory. Quote, "Hence the intellect, which has more of the light of glory, will see God the more perfectly," end quote. But Aquinas continues by arguing that the amount of the light of glory given us is dependent on how much charity we possess. Why? Because the more charity you have, the more desire you have. And desire, quote, "in a certain degree makes the one desiring apt and prepared to receive the object desired. Hence, he who possesses the more charity will see God the more perfectly and will be the more beatified," end quote. Love, then, has a kind of heat, so to speak, in which our interior grasping and our inability, which keeps us from a more perfect conformity to God, is broken down and overcome, and we're opened up. We've gone over several rich and abstract ideas, but before turning to Paradiso 3, to show how Dante brings all of these things together, I want to make one final point, that after staring up and seeing how the heavens are vibrantly alive, the paradigm of order, and feeling the brightness of the stars which bathes the heavens in joy and pure light, often the medieval poet could dejectedly turn his eyes back down, only to lament that the human community could not better resemble the world of the stars. Why couldn't individuals be content to be grouped in constellations? Don't they know that their beauty would be greater? Don't they know that their erratic, selfish movements ruin the dance? But the sad truth is, as Boethius was quick to point out, although nature has order, it's rarely the case that the society of man is regulated by those principles of justice. The very poet who basked in the warm music of the universe, Boethius, also ached when he thought about how little human society embodied that beautiful cosmic order. "Not even the blowing winds are random," he shouts with glee, "because God observes and orders all from his high office. But there's one creature who messes everything up." Only man is endowed with freedom, that you could constrain but have chosen not to. The innocent suffer, wicked men sit upon thrones, villains thrive and trample the necks of virtuous men into the mud. Look down from on high and impose your correction, you who bind all the world within your laws, who control the waves and the tides, bring order to the surging waves of mankind's follies, and steady us with your hand's firmness, you whose awesome power we see in the skies. Nature then obeys God perfectly, while man, being given the gift of freedom, rarely lives in a state of restful harmony. Well, with all this in mind, let's turn to see how Dante brings all this together in Paradiso 3. Dante and Beatrice are still in the heaven of the moon. And just as Dante is about to ask Beatrice another question, he sees, quote, "as through clear transparent glass, or through still and limpid waters, faces eager to speak." The face which is brightest and most eager to speak to Dante is that of Picarda Donati, the younger sister of Dante's old drinking buddy, Forese Donati, whom we met back in Purgatorio 23. You remember that there Dante did not at all recognize his old friend, on account of how emaciated he had grown through the extreme penitential fasting. And likewise here, he meets the younger sister, but she has grown so fair that Dante does not recognize her. He says to her, "From your transfigured faces shines forth a divinity I do not know, and it transforms the images I can recall. That's why my memory worked so slowly." Picarda points out that she is here in the lowest of the heavens because of vows neglected. Quote, "In the world I was a virgin sister, if you search your memory. My having grown more fair will not conceal my name, and you will recognize me as Picarda, placed here among those blessed souls. And blessed am I in the slowest of these spheres. Our affections, which are inflamed, only when they please the Holy Spirit, take joy in adherence to his plan. And this, our lot, which seems so very low, is given us because of vows neglected and in part no longer valid. The story goes that Picarda became a nun, but her ambitious and machinating older brother, Corso, that is, not Dante's buddy, but a different brother, had her forcibly removed from the monastery and married off. In the next canto, Dante struggles over this point. It seems a little unfair that Picarda gets demoted to the basement of heaven because of an act of violence that occurred to her against her will. But Beatrice addresses this problem head on. Even if violence is done when the one who bears it in no way consents to the one who deals it out, these souls were not excused on that account. For the will, except by its own willing, is not spent, but does as by its nature fire does inflame, though violence may force it down 1,000 times. Thus, if it stays bent, whether there much or little, it then accepts that force. In other words, Beatrice says that Picarda could have walked back to the convent every single day. She could have been like Mucius Scaevola, the ancient Roman hero, who, when caught in the enemy camp and ordered to be burned alive, stuck his hand into the fire and let it be burned off in order to demonstrate his commitment to the cause. St. Lawrence, also mentioned by Beatrice, refused to betray his Christian community and was tortured for it. According to pious legend, while being roasted alive, he said, "Turn me over because on this side I'm done." But Picarda and Costanza, the mother of Frederick II, did not have this irrepressible will. Even if they, quote, wore the veil on their hearts, they didn't have the resolve, like the fire which always rises up, to keep returning to the good to which they committed. This is the reason their reflective power is less than that of others. As soon as Dante realizes this, though, he's pricked by a question which would probably occur to any of us. If I saw a man every day on my walk to work who was 3 times better looking, 2 times more fit, 5 times happier, and 4 times wealthier, I admit I probably wouldn't like him. And similarly, Dante, who still has much of his earthly thinking with him, hesitantly asked Picarda, "But tell me, do you who are here content desire to achieve a higher place where you might see more and make yourselves more dear?" I gotta ask you, Picarda, is there just a small part of you that envies the others higher up? And Picarda makes the most amazing reply. Along with the other shades, she smiled, then answered me with so much gladness she seemed alight with love's first fire. "Brother, the power of love subdues our will, so that we long only for what we have, and thirst for nothing else. If we desired to be more exalted, our desires would be discordant with his will, which assigns us to this place. That, as you will see, would not benefit these circles. No, it's the very essence of this blessed state that we remain within the will of God, so that our wills combine in unity. Therefore, our rank from height to height through this kingdom pleases all the kingdom. In his will is our peace. It is to that sea all things move, both what his will creates and that which nature makes." Wow. A human will at peace. A human will which wants nothing more. A human will which loves what it has and longs not for more power, more money, more things, more beauty, more pleasure. Picarda understands that in a heaven of rubies and diamonds, she's just an opal or a jade. But she also understands that a jewelry store which only sold diamonds would be dull. You might think the red rose the most regal flower, but a garden which has nothing else would be monotonous. And so, in order to better proclaim the depth of beauty of God through the diversity of the beauties of his creatures, she's happy to accept her role. At the same time, her allusion to the sea and the circles of the heavens helps us see that the impossible has happened. The human community is now moving with that natural effortlessness which regulates the cosmos. You'll remember that in Beatrice's speech in Paradiso 1, she referred to the natural property of fire which rises up according to its nature. In contrast, Beatrice pointed out in Paradiso 4 that Paccarda in life, though she followed God, did not follow him with that naturalness of will akin to how the fire leaps. She allowed her fire to be bent, as it were. But in heaven, as we've said, the human community finally obeys God as effortlessly as the natural world moves. Here the human will moves in line with God's will, with the grace and peace that fire rises. If you think back to the heartbroken plea for help from Boethius I read a few minutes ago, then you can see what is so striking about Dante's depiction of heaven. True, his pilgrim soaks up the beauty of the luminescent bodies, delights in their beauty, and exults in their symphonic music. But most importantly, it's a human society which finally and at long last is not striving to move beyond the order which is appropriate for it. At last, the human society itself is a kind of ordered cosmos which resembles the ordered symphony of the heavenly spheres. It's for this reason that I think Paccarda is the most beautiful character in all of the comedy. She's a picture of a soul who's not just a member of the choir, but a note in the symphony which is sung.